Let's see. Hopefully this is working for everyone. If so, hello. Welcome to Literary Escapism's first Google Hangouts on Air. I'm hoping this is working because with me tonight, I have the fabulous author Jeaniene Frost, writer of the Cat and Bone series, and I'll let her do the more interesting intro because I'm sure she does it better than I do.
Not really, but hi, everyone. Thanks for coming out. I am the author of the Night Huntress series, the Night Huntress World novels, the Night Prince series, and the upcoming Broken Destiny series. The main creatures in all of my novels that are published now are vampires, but I also have ghouls, ghosts, demons, and some black magic thrown into the mix as well. And I'm happy to talk about all of my books and characters, but we're mainly, I think what brought it on is the release of my latest novel, Up From the Grave, which is the last novel in the Cat and Bone series, which is, officially called the Night Huntress series, but I think everyone calls them the Cat and Bones books. So that just came out on January 28th. And it wraps up a storyline that started back in 2007 with that couple. So I was excited to finally bring them to their conclusion with Up From the Grave. And I'm not done writing in the Night Huntress world, though. I still have at least one more novel in the Night Prince series, which features Vlad and Layla. And then at least one more novel in that world with a character as yet to be determined. And I've teased before that it may or may not be Ian. So I'm not saying no, but I'm not saying a definite yes either.
Well, since you brought up Ian, and I know you probably wish you had a dollar for every time someone asks this question, so I'm not going to word it the same way. But recently on Twitter, Melissa Marr and Alona Andrews kind of poured toward you. Has that really brought the timetable up a little, or is that still his stories and that hasn't really made its presence known yet?
You know, one of the comments I got on Twitter was, are these people really your friends? And the answer is yes. These are my friends, and this is what they do to me. Melissa Marr and Alona Andrews got together and thought it would be hilarious to send a Twitter assault my way to try and talk me into writing an Ian book. And Alona got the idea to have people tweet the words pork sword at me, because that's the most ridiculous euphemism for part of the male anatomy we had heard, and so it was a joke between us. And then it was Wednesday of last week. My cell phone, I'm out of town, you know, doing signings, vibrated all night long with alerts for people tweeting pork sword at me. I mean, the entire night. So at one point, I think I was crying out for mercy and saying, I will seriously consider an Ian book. Just please put down the pork swords. I have a story idea for Ian, but, you know, he is such a reader favorite. I want to make sure that I think I can do it in a way that is really reflects what I want to tell about Ian. So until I know that that story is solid in my mind, I'm not going to write it, because I wouldn't want to disappoint readers, you know, with something that wasn't my best effort. So the idea is there, which is more than I could say 2 years ago, and now it's just a matter of kind of fine-tuning it and being sure that I can make an entire book out of it. Because, again, I think if I just wrote a short story with Ian, people would come after me.
Oh yes, we definitely need lots of Ian. Although the question does, is the story not coming together because you don't have a female heroine for him, or because you're just not sure what kind of trouble to put him into?
Oh no, I know the heroine and I know the trouble.
All right, so this brings me up to a question. Has she made an appearance already? Because
yes.
I have an idea.
And I'm not saying who. I'm not going to say yes or no, because then I may as well just say who. So if you throw out a name, I have no comment as the answer. The only thing I have said publicly before is that it's not Justina. Because Ian would eat her alive, literally and metaphorically. He needs someone who is stronger than him in every capacity, because he is not... He doesn't think he's ready to, you know, fall in love. I think differently. So the heroine is going to have to be a very strong person to be able to, one, put up with Ian, and two, put him in line, pretty much, because he's got a lot of issues, one of them being that he's a slut. And, you know, no heroine worth her salt is going to put up with that.
Okay, then not to talk about Ian, and I won't say whom I would like. I'm thinking who, it's not just Dina who's on my head, but I do have another question. We've seen her pop up in more than one book. Will we see Veritas in the future?
Possibly. There's a lot of side characters in the world that I would like to do something with, and Veritas has an interesting background that I haven't been able to bring to light with her just being kind of a residual side character. So she's someone I would like to do possibly more with. So is Maximus from the Night Prince series. You know, I'd love to do more story. I'd love to do something a little more on Annette. I mean, there's a lot of different characters. If I care enough to make them a recurring side character, I probably have something in my head about them.
So possibly with Gorgon as well, too, then.
Sorry?
Gorgon, Mincheris, is this a servant?
Yeah, he's
popped up more than once, too.
Yeah, he's popped up a couple, and I have some ideas about him. A little bit smaller focus. I don't have a story about him yet, but a little bit smaller focus. But he's also an interesting one where, you know, if you write a side character, I think you have to know more about them than you can put on the page, or they're come across as very cardboard. So I do know Gorgon's history, and I haven't been able to really share it, but he's not one of the front runners yet.
So does this mean that even though you've completed the Night Huntress series, you're not entirely done with the world, so we might see some novellas in the future, just not right away?
I'm pretty much saying I'm done writing a novel, full novel, through the viewpoint of Kat, the way the Night Huntress series has been. I haven't ruled out one day if I get an itch to do maybe like a short story featuring a day in the new life of Cat and Bones, you know, or something like that. Just kind of a little thing for, you know, for just to give readers a glimpse. But it wouldn't be a full novel with a full overarching plot. I haven't ruled out, though, Cat and Bones appearing as side characters, as they have in this side world in spinoff novels. Like, they appeared in Eternal Kiss of Darkness, they appeared in First Drop of Crimson, they appeared in Once Burned and Twice Tempted. So they will still show up there for sure. They also might get a little bit of a spotlight in a short story just for fun. Not a real story arc, though.
Speaking of the Night Prince novels, there's supposed to be a third one coming out, and I know you talked about it a little in Dane, but do you have a tentative idea of when it will be released? Are you working on it, or is this something after you've gotten through with your first or second novel, Broken Destiny?
I'm so close to finishing the Broken Destiny novel. If I wouldn't have gone on tour, I would be done. So as soon as I'm done with that, I start, hi, kitty. You can see Jackie's cat, if anyone's wondering why I'm all of a sudden saying that. Her cat's lonely, wants attention. As soon as I'm done with that novel, The Beautiful Ashes, I will start Night Prince number 3. And we're not really sure then when it's going to come out, either the end of this year or the beginning of next year, because it's not like I finish a book and then 2 weeks later it's on the shelves. You know, it has to go through revisions and then copy edits and then galleys and then, you know, the entire production process. So by the time I turn in a book, I think the fastest it's ever been spit out is 6 months. So that's why I'm not sure quite yet as to when the date will be.
Will we get to see any more of Juan and Cooper and the rest of Kat's old team in any of the future books?
I'd like Hopefully. To. You know, they're fun. I mean, they're fun characters to write about, and they're in a different, you know, place in their lives now, after the events and Up from the Grave. So I would like to show them kind of in their positions now of, well, really, you know, I don't want to spoiler. We'll save the spoilers for the end. But in their new positions, it would be nice to show something about them. So that's a hopefully.
Now, I know you said you've ended the 900 series a book early. Have you, what kind of, I don't want to say backlash, but have you seen anything really, what's been the reader response? More, I mean, was there anything unexpected in the reader response ending the series early?
I think most readers who read my post about why it ended early, where I explained that, you know, basically I had come to the outline of books 7 and 8, and when I was halfway done writing Up from the Grave, I was done with all of the outline for book 7. So it was either add filler or ended early. And I did not want to write a book with filler, so I ended it early. And most readers were behind that. They were like, well, I'm kind of sad that it ended early, but I don't want to read a book with filler either. And, you know, so the response to that post was overwhelmingly in support of doing that. I did get a couple people like, well, you suck for ending it early. And, you know, you expect some, you know, and that's their honest opinion on how they feel, so they're entitled to it. But mostly people have understood. When they hear the reason, they understand. And I think it's just a case of, you know, realizing that authors are human, and we estimate and do the best we can to say how long a series lasts. But if you've come to the end of the story, you're at the end of the story. And that's what happened with Up from the Grave.
Now the book's been... The book has been out for about 2 weeks at this point. What has reader response?
I know, it feels like a blur.
Well, it's because you've been traveling too. But have you? What's been the response? I'm like, there's one of the questions that's popped up is why your latest Cambones book was so different from the others. The mojo between the characters was off. There was no real romance, and it seemed rushed. Have you been getting a lot of that type of feedback, or what's been the overall impression?
You know. My impressions are limited to what readers email me directly on, and also what they reply, you know, what they reply on my Facebook page or my Twitter page. So my responses are kind of limited to that because I don't really go out and I don't actively read reviews. And here's why. It's like running up to a group of people talking about you and sticking your ears out so you can overhear. That conversation is not meant for you. Reviews are a conversation of readers for readers, so I step away from that. And so I'm sure I'm not getting an entire picture of reader response. I can say that for the people that have contacted me, most people seem happy with the ending. There are some people who are like, well, I wish that X wouldn't have happened, or I wish that this wouldn't have happened, but the rebel happened with the ending. As far as the level of heat and romance in the book, there was a lot happening, and I can't, I think, Jackie, by the way, we were going to mention that if there are spoiler questions about Up from the Grave, we're going to save those for the last 10 minutes, so go ahead and ask them, and I will answer them in detail. So if you haven't read Up from the Grave and you don't want to know spoilers, when we say, okay, spoiler time, turn your computer off, because I'm happy to go into detail with people who have already read it and who would like more specific answers. So I apologize if I'm being a little vague now. But there was so much going on that for Cat and Bones to kind of stop to get horny, really, it seemed out of place. There is a scene where, you know, there's a sex scene in the book, but I think it fit because it was led by emotion, and it was led by emotions upon a scene that had just happened. It was very, you know, traumatic in the novel. So that made sense for me to put it there. But I'm not going to write something for the sake of gratuitousness. Anytime I've written a sex scene, it's because I felt like it was necessary for the plot or to show the emotional situation of the character. And, you know, sometimes that means some books are a little sexier than others. But I really don't think that just putting a scene in there for the sake of, quote-unquote, spicing it up is something that I wouldn't feel comfortable doing it. And I also think readers can spot an insincere effort. I mean, if I'm just slashing it on the page to put it there, I think readers are going to know, and they're not going to appreciate that either. So I'd almost rather have them wanting more than saying, you know, I can tell you just phone that in.
Was this how you always planned on ending the Night Huntress series, or did the ending change as the series developed?
Well, I don't remember how long I've planned this ending, because I first got the idea of Cat and Bones about 11 years ago. So it's been a long time. And I had written the first three, maybe even four novels well before I sold the first one. So at some point after, and some of those versions have never seen the light of day, by the way, because that was when I didn't know things like stay on plot and don't betray your world building, you know, little writer tips. So I've known it for years and years, possibly since the first novel has been published. I won't swear to it, but it's been pretty darn long. And but it hasn't been since the first idea of the series, because when I started writing it, I thought it was a one-book story. So that ought to give you an indication of how much I underestimated the storyline for Cat and Bones. But it has been years. And in the novels, I think readers might be able to now see the little breadcrumbs that have been dropped along the way in the published novels that have led up to the events in Up from the Grave. So this wasn't something I just thought up. This is an ending I've been deliberately working toward since the books have been published.
Now, has there been anything over the course of the series that worked out well in the beginning, but now once you got to like this final book, was it like, oh crap, I so should not have done that?
I mean, there's all sorts of, I don't think anything major. There's all sorts of little things that I've kicked myself on in world building, because, you know, writing a paranormal world is so cool in that you get to make up all your own rules. But then once you've made them up, there they are. You're stuck with them. You can't break them without a really, really good reason for readers. So there have been times when I've wished vampires could be mesmerized, but I said in book one that they can't. So I've had to try and think of a way around that to explain why certain things happened. You know, like Kat's total lack of memory of Gregor that came out in Destined for an Early Grave. I had to come up with, originally I had a different reason for why it happened, and I had to come up with something else, or it would have betrayed the world building. And, oh gosh, let me think of another example of things I've gritted my teeth over. I thought it was really cool to add in the ideas that vampires have a very advanced sense of smell. You know, like a bloodhound on steroids, I think it was described once. And then once Kat became a vampire, every scene I wrote, I had to add something in about her scent. Because before, she would walk into a room and, you know, not really, maybe not know what happened. And now if she walks into it and someone she knows was in there, she should be able to smell it. So it was having to rewrite things or pay careful attention to nuances that I don't think of, because I can't smell anything aside from, like, really good odors or really bad ones. And then I had put emotions to scents. So I had to look back on my spiral notebook. Okay, what does anger smell like? What does fear smell like? I don't remember. What did I say it smelled like before? And then look that stuff up. So those are little details that I think it added a layer to the story, but as a writer, I've kicked myself over.
Now, all the women in the series have been kick-ass in some manner. You haven't had anyone who's been like the weak, oh, please do this for me. So, I just lost where my train of thought went. Oh. my questions keep moving at me, so I was going to use one, and it just kind of left me. Anyway. I'll find a minute. All right, I'll come back to that one in a second, because I had a train of thought. So, here's a question from one, I'm going to start pulling from the question queues just so we don't run out of time, because they have a lot of really good questions in there, actually. The first one is Don's situation ever going to change from where you left it at the end of the series?
Well, that depends. If the question is he still going to be a ghost? The answer is yes. Explained in Up From the Grave why he ended up as a ghost, that it kind of wasn't just a case where I've said, you know, he had one more thing left to do and then he could pass on. He finds out how he ended up as a ghost, and that situation is permanent. He is a ghost, and he will remain a ghost, and there is no timeout button for that for him.
Well,
If it's his relationship with Kat, I think the ending kind of shows that essentially that there's hope for that.
Oh, there it is. There's the question I was looking for. All right. So the question is, with all the female characters in the series, and they've all been kick-ass, will we ever see them as being another focus? Like, all the spin-offs have been about the guys of the series, like Vlad, Spade, Mancheris, but will we see anyone focus primarily on the girl, like Justina, Marie, or even Veritas?
You know, well, I mean, First Drop of Crimson was about Spade and Denise. To me, that book was equally hers as well. I did introduce a new character with Vlad and Mancheris as far as the heroine. So those were new chicks on the block, essentially. I think that the answer is, yeah, I'd like to do more stories with some of those female characters. I don't really know which one yet. I think I said before at a signing, you know, describing my process kind of sounds like letting the inmates run the asylum, because the characters are in my head and they're all swirling around up there. And basically, whoever starts showing me bits of their story more and more and more and more until I can't think about anything else, that's who gets a book. So, whichever character starts growing and growing in my mind until I know all these fascinating to me, details about their story, and then I've got everything written down to where I've got a book worth of material, they win. And it's kind of depends, I guess, on which voice is the most loud and in my sort of pseudo-schizophrenic writing process. But I love writing those characters, and I do love writing about strong women, and especially like Marie, because she's such an interesting character, that I'd love to do something one day with. But she's also a frightening character. I mean, she scares me.
Well, and she's like, where Kat came in, she had a reputation, but she's had to build it over the course of the books. Marie already has this giant, larger-than-life power behind her.
Yeah.
I mean, that would have to be very ballsy for any guy to even think of being the next Jocks and not be named Jock.
Yeah, exactly. How do you get out of that nickname that she gives all her men because they're dispensable? She would be someone I'd really have to think about who would be a good match for her, because wow, they would have to be really strong and have quite a bit of their own history as well, or they would not be worth her time.
Well, and over the course of this, another character that's been very, I believe, well-received, because you in the first book, you wanted to hate her, and you just can't hate Justina anymore. She's just hilarious.
Oh, there are people who can.
Well, I can't. I'm like, especially when she and Ian the first interaction between her and Ian, hilarious. And especially the way she fell for Rodney. But now that he's been off the scene for quite a while and is not coming back, has she ever peeped up and wanted someone else, or do you think she will forever be by herself now?
No, she won't forever be by herself. I really don't think so. I think that right now, as of the events that happened at the end of Up from the Grave, she's not looking for a relationship. She's got something else going on. But I think that she will eventually find someone else, because she is a loving person. She's just had so much bad happen in her life that she convinced herself that she wasn't. And you know, through Kat's eyes, through most of the first and second books, she definitely does not come across as a loving person. But again, you're only seeing her through Kat's side of the story. You're not seeing Justina, who at one point was just like Kat, and who was, you know, a young, headstrong girl who wanted to get the heck out of that small little town and the rather oppressive, you know, rules of her parents, and who ended up having to go back there to protect what she thought was a demon child. So Justina's had a lot happen to her, and I'd love to show more of her, because I think readers would maybe empathize with her more than they would think they'd be able to now.
Now that the series has ended, how are you feeling overall? Are you happy with, I mean, I'm assuming you're happy with the way it ended, but was there anything that, even though you ended it early, that you wish you still would have snuck in there in some way?
Not with Cat and Bones' story of themselves. There's more peripheral story about the world that I still want to tell about. Like, for example, people have said to me, whatever happened to the fourth guy that was sent to the colonies with Bones, Ian, you know, Spade, and, you know, his name is Timothy. They're like, whatever happened to him? You mention him, and then he just goes away. That's deliberate. I know exactly where he is. He's not dead. I know why he hasn't contacted his friends, and I know what he's been doing. And I really want to turn that into, I thought it would make a subplot in the Cat and Bones books, but I realize it's going to end up probably as either a subplot of another character's book or its own story. So I'm definitely not done with the world, but as far as stories that are very particular to Cat and Bones, through her viewpoint, the way the Night Huntress series has been, that I felt good about closing the chapter on, because I think they deserve a break from the things that I do to them when I'm writing about them.
Any of the characters, did you base any of them on anyone in your personal life?
No.
And any shadow of a way?
No, I mean, I've said before, there was like one tiny itty-bitty side character in the first Night Huntress novel who basically shows up and gets killed 3 pages later, and he's a crack vampire. And when I say crack vampire, I don't mean crack shot. I mean he's a crack smoking vampire. And he was based on this coworker I had had many, many years ago who was a crack smoking coworker. And if you've ever tried to work with someone who's on crack, you'll understand the difficulties and frustrations because they don't remember anything they say. So he ended up dead in the first Night Huntress book, and that was me exercising a little of my frustration for years of having to deal with that person as my coworker. Although I don't wish that person dead in real life. It is fiction after all.
With the rise in the urban fantasy and paranormal movies coming out and tons of books being turned into movies, it seems like anymore, and I know you've at one point had posted on your website, on your blog, who you would want to play Cat and Bones and anything like that. Has any of those actors changed? I mean, is there anyone that's in your head that you've seen that is like, oh my God, this is her or this is him?
Probably, because I posted that years ago because readers keep asking me that question. So I posted, I'm like, okay, here. but, you know, actors get older since then. And since I first thought of Cat and Bones, again, it's been 11 years and, you know, people aren't vampires. Age happens. So as far as female versions of current actresses today that are the age that Cat, is when the series starts and she doesn't physically get older, really, as the series goes on, I would say the closest I could come up with would be Scarlett Johansson after seeing her in Iron Man 2 when she put on that black outfit and just beat the hell out of everyone, you know, at the end of the movie. And I thought that could be Kat. She's got that sweet look. She's got that curvy body because Kat's, you know, she's not stick thin. And she's absolutely lethal. So that would be the closest I could come to for Kat. And Bones is just, he's almost impossible. In my head, there's no one who looks like he does or has his persona that I've seen on, that I've seen in real life. Or I'd probably become a stalker fan.
To bring up, like, this is the end, and you're starting a new series this August, the Beautiful Destiny, the Broken Destiny series, which starts, What can you give us anything that you haven't said already about this series?
The series is called the Broken Destiny series. It's a trilogy. And the first book is called Beautiful Ashes, and I just recently posted the description on my website, so the back of the book jacket is now up on my website for the description, I'm so bad at describing my novels, by the way. This is one of the reasons probably why it took me forever to get an agent, because I hated query letters and trying to summarize things in a nice, succinct fashion. But it's about my heroine, Ivy, who has had hallucinations her whole life. So she pretty much has just thought, well, I have a medical condition, you know, and she's trained herself to kind of ignore them and not pay attention to them because she's sick of going to doctors and, you know, taking meds because nothing seems to help. And her sister goes missing, and she starts looking for her sister because her sister texted her and said she was trapped in the last town that she was in was a little town called Bennington, Maine. So she goes to Bennington looking for her sister, and once she gets there, basically someone tries to kidnap and kill her. So she finds out when the hero jumps into the scene, Adrian, that everything she has seen her whole life is true, and that there are different realms just beyond our regular perception that exist, and they're demon realms. And she ends up a pretty much significant player in the war between angels, which I call archons, and demons. And she finds out she has an unwanted destiny that is the reason why she has these visions and kind of these strange things that has happened to her whole life. And even more complicated is the hero has a destiny he doesn't want, and that's to end up kind of being her doom. And then they fall in love. Because, again, I'm evil, and that's what I do to my characters.
Now, how different will this world be from your Night Huntress world? I mean, is there going to be any similarities? Because I know we've seen demons with cat and bones.
Yes, so these are totally different. Aside from calling them the same name, they're totally different mythology as far as the world building goes. So it's a completely separate world. There are no vampires. There are no ghosts. This is totally starting from scratch as far as the world goes. So it's still a paranormal world, though, and it's a closed world, like the Night Huntress series is, whereas everyone doesn't, like in the Night Huntress series, everyone doesn't know that vampires and ghouls exist. In this world, everyone doesn't know that demons and archons exist, or they're at war. I mean, you know, there's religions that hint about that, but no one really walks down the street and expects to brush shoulders with a demon or an angel or archon, again, as they're called. So it's a closed world setting in that regard.
Now, will the only supernatural characters involved be demons and angels, or could we see other, like, magic users, werewolves, or any of the other supernaturals pop up?
Well, there's also minions, which are essentially like demon Renfields. And they're embedded with supernatural power to serve the demons. And the demons are very varied in this world. They're not all what you would consider human. Like, I have a kind of hound demon that I've said looks like what would happen if a Komodo dragon got it on with a werewolf. So there's all sorts of different creatures within the demon mythology that's more varied than just what a normal person would look like that would just also happen to be a demon. So I'm playing around a lot in that, and I'm having fun with it. Because there's actually, I think, there's more for me to do in vampires. Because if it's a vampire, it's a vampire. They were a person, now they're a vampire. So they've got, you know, they look like a person. But with demonology, you can have creatures and people that, you know, that look like persons. And you can also have them be disembodied. Like they can come in a mist or a cloud or something like that. So it's been able to open things up. I'm having fun with it. Which is an odd thing to say. I'm having fun with my demons. It's really not a sentence you should hear people say.
Well, that depends on what the fun is, too, though. I mean, you have fun with them sometimes. Now, do you have a set number? Like you said before, that Night Huntress was going to be 9 books, even though it only ended up being 8. You have a set. I know it's not a set number, but do you have an idea of how far you can take this series?
Yeah, I know. No one's going to believe me with numbers, and I can't blame them. I right now, this story is a trilogy in my mind. I have, you know, the plot in my head, the main plot for the books, it's a 3-book arc, it's a trilogy. Because I have been wrong before, if I find that the story, like that my 3rd plot arc takes 2 books, that could happen. Or I could wrap it up in actually 3 books, like I said. It's hard to know. Right now, I'm almost done with the first book, and it's completed the plot arc that I wanted to complete in the first book, so I feel like I'm on track for a trilogy.
So, there's one, I have looking at my queue, I have one last question before we get to anything that's truly spoilerish. Okay. So I have someone who wants to know if there will ever be a book, a story, a novella, anything written from Bones' point of view.
Well, there already is a novella written from Bones' point of view. It's called Reckoning, and it's it originally came out in an anthology called Unbound several years ago, but it's available as a single purchase ebook now. So if you haven't read that yet, it takes place right before Bones meets Cat. So it shows him in his days as a badass hitman, essentially. And as far as doing something else from his point of view post-Cat, I've thought about it. I've toyed with the idea of, you know, maybe showing them meeting through Bones' point of view and writing that out. So it's something that sounds fun to me, and it's something that I would, that I might end up doing one day. Right now, I've got too much on my plate to do it right now, though. Because in addition to the three Broken Destiny series novels, you know, I have to finish Vlad and Layla up and then at least one more novel in that world. And as you can tell, I have plenty of other ideas for the Night Huntress world, too. So I wish I had a couple clones. I would be able to write so much more efficiently then.
If you could market, if you could figure out how to get clones, I'm sure you would get your $1 million at that point easily.
Yeah, I wouldn't need to write. I'd just be sitting back cashing checks.
Yeah, okay, because I would be first in line. All right, for those watching, we are going to go into a slight spoiler section. We're not going to try and get anything too hardcore, but there were some new developments and up from the grave that I'm sure that I have at least one person who wants to know. I take that back. I have two people who want to know more about. So we're going to go into a slightly spoiler section. So for those who
are... Is it slightly spoiler or big spoiler? I consider any spoilers big spoilers.
It's just a name at this point. Okay. So we don't have to go into specifics. So for those disappearing on me, make sure you come back after you read the book, and that way it's not a spoiler. So the appearance of Katie into the series.
Yes.
Well, according to this, I'm not going to say who, but she says it seems predictable and an unnecessary move. What do you say to that?
I mean, you know what? Some people, it's funny because reader response is so personalized, as it should be, you know? And some people have said, wow, Katie came out of nowhere. I absolutely, you know, I predicted blah, you know, I predicted Bones doing what he did, you know, on the pier, and I predicted, you know, this and that, but I absolutely didn't predict Katie. And then other people were like, oh, well, I knew right away from the prologue what was going on. Or, you know, or I could tell from One Grave at a Time that this is what was happening as soon as Madigan was introduced. So really, it's individual to the reader. For the reader that predicted Katie, she's predictable. For the ones who, you know, who didn't see her coming, then she was a surprise. For the ones that kind of were in between and thought it was possible and didn't realize it would happen under quite these circumstances, then, you know, they had a little bit idea, but they didn't see it turning out in quite that fashion. So as an author, you can never tell. I mean, I've had ideas where I thought this was early on, I would think, oh, I have an idea, it's so original. No, it's not. I've come to grips with that. Everything has been done before, multiple times. And so as an author, all you can do is put your own spin on the story that you have. So if I sat back and tried to write something totally new, totally original, totally predictable, it's already been done before. Somewhere, somehow, by someone. So all I can do is write the story that's in my head and hope that more readers than not enjoy the story. Which is why I've always said, I never advocate writing to trends. Writing is a hard business, and publishing is a harder business. If you don't at least love your story yourself, whether, you know, other people think it's good, bad, or ugly, you're just going to get emotionally destroyed in this business. So all you can do is love your story, release it into the world, and hope for the best.
Now, there was one part of the book that kind of made me question. It was like, the idea of Cat and Bones hiding things from each other was dealt with in the past. What made Bones do it again?
he knows Cat. He knows her. And he knows her flaws and her limitations. And for as much as Kat has grown throughout the course of the series by, you know, a lot, especially when it comes to her trust issues, Kat is still Kat. And some things are just deep in her. And she's worked on them a lot, but working on your issues doesn't always make them vanish. And so Bones knew that about her and acted the way he did because he is Bones and he is going to keep her safe pretty much regardless of what it takes. So that's why he did it. And as far as her not figuring it out until it kind of slapped her in the face, again, it also goes back to her own issues. She should have thought it through more. But, you know, when the scene happened, she was so emotionally devastated, her feelings were at the wheel, not her logic.
Now, did Bones take that into consideration? Because that almost completely backfired on him.
Yeah, and that just goes to show sometimes he does know her and he knows her very well, but sometimes people have knee-jerk reactions that are not terribly healthy. And he thought he had that base covered, you know, when he mentioned to her, you know, you promised me you weren't going to do this. And she said, I changed my mind. You know, I think given time, though, she wouldn't have. Because I think it very much would have, that's her knee-jerk reaction of being overwhelmed. And her resolve would have risen to the surface. And that's what Bones was counting on. And he was also counting on Madigan not letting her do that because he wanted her. So he was trusting Kat's resolve and in some ways trusting his enemy's worst qualities.
But at the same time, he wasn't putting much trust in her abilities either at that point because he assumed she wouldn't deal with Madigan.
He assumed that she would underestimate Madigan, and he was right. Because Kat has a bit of she's had a reckless streak. And again, she's gotten better. She's gotten more mature as the series has progressed. But she is still who she is. And, you know, it's funny because when I imagined the end of the series, I kind of thought she would be over that myself. And then when writing it, I realized, no, this is still very much a part of her. And she's getting it under control, but she can't quit it. Her instinct is her instinct. She sees something. She sees the bad guy. She goes after him. And that's part of why Bones fell in love with her. And yet it's also part of why he's wanted to probably throttle her on more than several occasions.
And like Ian says, this is what you want. Deal with it.
Yes. And that's true. And, you know, isn't that common in a lot of relationships? What attracts you most to a person in the beginning is what you can't stand later.
Yes. But here's an interesting part, too. The Katie's origin.
Okay, now that's big spoiler time, people. Big spoiler time.
I'm not saying what her origin is.
We can say it. It's the last 10 minutes. We can totally say it.
Katie's origin is tied with Kat and her team. Why is Tate the only one who had any kind of say in it?
Okay.
Why were the other three brought in?
Big ending spoiler for the series. Big ending spoiler for the series. Everyone who hasn't read the series and doesn't know, shut your computers off in 3, 2, 1, and big spoiler time. Okay. It's not certain that Tate is the father. It's just by process of elimination where Kat was looking back at the timetable of, okay, this is when they were harvesting my eggs. I know that they were using, you know, they were using sperm from the members of the team because that's what Madigan said. So it was her looking back of who stayed. Like, what's the probability? If they would be pulling sperm more than once, like they were harvesting her eggs more than once, because they said out of, like, over 100 attempts, only one worked. Whose sperm would have been there the most, essentially? And Tate was the only one who hung through the team, really, those first 2 years. It could have been another guy. But he's, if you look at just probabilities, he has a higher probability than, say, Joe Soldier, who came and went. Although it's entirely possible that it was just another soldier that came and went or came and died. So I've left that deliberately open because Kat doesn't know, and Tate doesn't know, and there is no way to know. And sometimes that is just life. You don't always get the answer.
But wouldn't Tate, or wouldn't Juan Cooper or Dave have just as much of a high probability for
it? They weren't there as long. If you look back at the beginning of the series, it says that Juan was taken on after a couple years. But you got a shocked look on your face.
No, nothing. Keep going.
Oh, it said that Juan, you know, Juan wasn't one of the first members of the teams. It took him a couple years. Also, you know, Cooper was one of the most recent recruits into the team. He only came on at the beginning of One Foot in the Grave. Dave was also took him a couple years into the team. So all of her, the guys that are introduced in One Foot in the Grave, the only one that had been there from the beginning was Tate. And the other ones came on after.
Okay. Two quick questions, and my panic look was because my battery light had just flashed.
Okay. I saw you like, are your kids okay? Is your cat okay?
No, they're all okay. I just had the ding come up. I'm like, oh, I can yell at my husband real quick. So someone is on Chapter 7. And they want to know any advice on how to get through the rest of the book, knowing this is the last book.
Keep flipping pages?
No, I mean, like, because for someone who's been there the whole time, I mean, knowing it's the last book is very much different in knowing that there's going to be another book to look forward to. So even though there's this emotionally intense situation, it's all good because you know there's a happy ending, but you don't know what happens after this.
Well, the world isn't dead, you know, and Cat and Bones, you know, this isn't a spoiler. They don't die at the end. You know, I've always said that if readers follow through to the end of the series, Cat and Bones will have their HEA. So it's not that they drove off the cliff Thelma and Louise style and it's ending in that regard. It's just they're finally in the place that the series has been pushing them toward this whole time. And I think, you know, they're happier where they are. I mean, they're getting some well-deserved time together, you know, without trying to save the world or people actively trying to kill them at the moment. So, I mean, I was happy to leave them in that place where they will be able to focus mostly on each other and on their new family. So to you know, the reader who doesn't want to say goodbye, it's not a hard goodbye, because you'll still see them in other novels, and you know, and one day, I've said before, and because it's spoiler time, I can say it now, I would like to write something from Katie's point of view, maybe fast-forwarding 10 years into the future, and because she's, you know, she is so unique, and her circumstances are so, they're so rife with things I can write about, because she has to hide herself from every single member of society, and yet she is not going to be a delicate wilting flower. She can't, not with how she was brought up. So I wanted to show things happening with her, which would showcase Cat and Bones an entirely new role as parents. So that's also fun to me, and I think a way to revisit them without putting them forefront in a novel. If I would do a novel with Katie, it would be Katie's novel and they would be side characters. But they would be still side characters that would have, you know, a significant part of her life as her parents.
Now, you said maybe like Katie in 10 years. What about doing Katie as is, just like as she's learning too, because she's, like you said, she grew up in this very intense circumstance with this way she grew up. Try not to be too spoilery, but trying to switch off that programming almost would seem like it'd be kind of interesting as well. Like, does she understand that she can't tell people who she is? Why is she so accepting of Kat when she hears who she is? And it could be a YA novel, honestly.
Well, the reason why I don't want to do that is because it would be so It will require about 10 years to get her to the point where it's not just showing the same thing over and over again of her having to relearn every day the programming and the conditioning that was brought into her. You know, I mean, can you imagine her at a schoolyard and someone takes her toy? Like, she'd be like, "Oh, snap, you're not getting 3 seconds. Problem solved. Toy is mine." You know, she would have to relearn everything, and that would be, I think, not a book a lot of people would want to read. I think that's called Parenting from Hell. Who would want to read that? So the reason why I think it would be more interesting for me to fast forward is to show her with that work being done, yet like Cat and like Bones, she might be able to control it, but it would still be a very internal part of her that she would have to deal with on a day-to-day basis, yet not deal with it to the extreme that she would while she's unlearning all of the behavior. And also because it's more fun for me to write about, you know, a young woman who, what happens when she wants to date? That's going to happen. And, you know, who's she going to come across? Is she going to want to date the average guy down the street? And good Lord, how is Kat going to take that? Because if it's a human, she can kill him in, again, 3 seconds flat. If it's a vampire, she has to hide. If it's a ghoul, she has to hide. So what are her options? And when she wants to be out from under her parents' protective wings, what about the internal struggle with that? That's a struggle every, you know, late teenager faces. And imagine when the entire supernatural world would want to kill you, what that would be like.
I would be almost afraid of having to come home and say, "Bones, Tate, meet my boyfriend." Right
and
there.
That sounds like a fun scene for me to write. Because Bones would handle it much better than Kat. Like, I can totally see Bones giving a sex ed chat that would just make Kat cry and vomit. So these are things that amuse me.
Yeah, I guess, I think I was looking more as he would be overprotective, as in I know what can actually go on and not happening. I guess I was thinking about that.
But Bones is a lot more laid back. Cat would be a lot more hyper. He would be like, if anything goes wrong, I'll kill the guy. You know, again, but this is an easy fix. Or I'll mesmerize him and he'll think that his penis fell off. I mean, these are solutions Bones would think of. He would be far more relaxed. Cat would get more hyper.
That pretty much
sums up the series.
that would be true. So, all right, one last question, because we're still in the spoiler section, and we'll call it good, because we are actually on an hour at this point. I'm surprised. Katie, will she age? How human is she? Is she going to age slowly? Will she stop aging at a certain point? Or is she going to... Because it says in the books that she's human with these other qualities, correct?
She's tri-species. She is one-third human, one-third vampire, one-third ghoul, essentially. And she has aged more than her appearance because of the growth hormones and genetic tampering that Madigan did to make her a more effective soldier, despite her age. So when she is 18, she will likely look like she is in her early 20s. Now, will she essentially stop the way Kat did once she reached full, you know, maturity, and Kat is a half vampire, stopped aging, or at least stopped aging in a normal manner? Will that happen to Katie? Possibly. Will she start developing a craving for blood after she goes through puberty? Kat's abilities flared in puberty. Katie hasn't hit that yet, even though she's been advanced. You know, will she start developing ghoul tendencies? These are all things that are up in the air right now, and they're things that, again, that they give me all kinds of story ideas about. So Katie will age into she will complete puberty and age through that. But the question is, what then? And what does that mean for Cat and Bones if her aging almost stops the way Cat's did, because their plan was to protect her until she lived a normal life, but if her normal life could potentially be 400 years, then what does that mean for them? Because is it realistic that they can keep her hidden for that long? Maybe not.
No. Especially now if she finds men.
Yeah, again, there's that too, because she's not going to want to be sheltered too long, just like most independent, you know, strong-thinking people do not want to be sheltered that long. So it's issues will come up.
If she's human, does that mean she can be turned to one of the other, like, turned full ghoul or turned full vampire? Or, I mean, if so, could, I
but
mean,
she's not just human. She has already both, she has all, she has ghoul and vampire DNA compatible right now. So even if she, could she be turned to one or the other? Maybe. But then would that relinquish the other part of her that already exists? There's never been someone like her before. Because she already has the tri-nature. Kat was born with only a dual nature, half vampire, half human. Katie doesn't have a dual nature. She has a tri-nature.
So it's possible that if she was to be turned, she would end up kind of like Kat is and having a weird, freaky diet and possibly kind of sort of fitting in, but possibly not, because we don't know.
Exactly.
Okay. Well, like I said, we've been on for an hour, so I don't want to tie up too much, and I don't really want this being so long that people stop listening, because I hope they didn't. We've had a good 27 viewers all night long, and I'm just excited for that. Thank you, everyone, for watching.
Thank you for coming out.
Thank you, Jeaniene, for being willing to be my first on-air interview. This has been quite the experience.
Yes, thanks a lot for inviting me. It's fun to do the chat. And yeah, I'm always happy to get a chance to talk to readers because I know not everyone can come to the signings. And at least with the internet, you know, the geography boundaries aren't there. So it's fun to be able to do this.
Yep. And I just want to say for anyone who's still watching, this will be the YouTube video of this will be posted on literaryescapism.com tomorrow, along with a contest for a signed copy of Up From the Grave. So if you want a chance, make sure you come back to the site tomorrow and take a look. So that's why I got three of them signed last week. So thank you again, and hopefully we'll see everyone around.
All right. Thank you, guys. Good night.